Welcome, everybody. I really firstly just wanted to thank everybody for their volunteering for the sport of sailing. Very much appreciated, and especially for all the time zones around the world to get together and the going through the difficulties of meeting virtually. So thank you for your patience. Also wanted to thank all the registered observers. Thank you for your interest in the offshore component of our sport. And attending today's meeting. Firstly, I just wanted to record my thanks for the previous chair, Stan Honey. Stan, thank you so much for all the terrific work you've done in the past for the sport. I've enjoyed working with you so much in the past, and the great thing is you're still on the committee, so I really appreciate your inputs in the past, but also going forward. So thank you very much. Tonight, for me, and the morning for most people, we're going to run a reasonably tight schedule. So I really am going to only allow people, on most occasions, to talk once to a particular topic or a submission. So please think ahead about what you want to say because we don't want to continue discussions unnecessarily. I will be changing the order of the agenda just slightly for logistical reasons. So I'm going to be bringing item number six up after item three, which is the offshore doubles. Hopefully, Larry has got a logistical, I think his son's getting married. So we're going to bring him up the order if he's in the meeting in time. On item 10, which is the offshore special reg submissions. We'll go through that in a bit more detail. Obviously, Sally will talk to that later on in the agenda. We will attempt to vote on those submissions as a block, but if any committee member would like any of the submissions to be pulled out, so any particular submissions are not voted on as a block, then feel free. But I just wanted to give you notice that that's the way we'll be handling it, unless any of the committee members want to pull anything out. I'll just remind people that our vote on the OSR submissions are final, and this is the final approval for any changes. And then it goes to council for notification, but they are unable to overturn our decisions. So they're very important decisions that we make today. Thank you for all those people who circulated their short resumes after our preliminary meeting recently. That was, I think, a more time-effective way of people getting to know each other in the virtual world. Can I also remind members to review their conflicts of interest register if they've not done so already and update them if necessary. We will be having at least one short break during the meeting. So it's going to be hard to work out exactly when we're going to have that break, but it'll probably only be a very short break. Just time to stretch your legs or get a cup of tea or coffee. So thank you very much. And now I'd just like to hand it across to our Vice President, Reporting Vice President, Philip Baum. Philip, welcome, and be very keen for you to welcome the rest of the committee and any update you have from the board's perspective. Thank you.
Matt, thank you very much. I'll keep it brief in the interest of time, but just to record my pleasure at being the liaison for the board with Oceanic and Offshore, and I'd like to echo your remarks about Stan. It was my great privilege in my early days at World Sailing to find myself at the table of Stan and Sally way back when at the awards dinner, and I had a great introduction and a great evening, and it's now a great privilege to be associated with both of them in this space. From the board, just to say that happily, thanks to the good efforts of David Graham and Raksha, we are very much in a better space in terms of our finances. We are in the process of resolving the office situation with a considerable saving in the offing. And we've had the first of our IOC post-Enoshima payments. And so the challenge that was made to me at the informal oceanic and offshore discussion about resourcing the area of work that supports this and other activities in the offshore area will see a judicious but an additional funding coming in support of the good work that gets taken here. So it behoves me to thank you all for the great work that you do and the involvement that you have, and wish you well with your deliberations. And hopefully, if we get support from the M&As on Saturday in terms of continuing with governance work, I just want to assure you that it's the board's intention to engage with all stakeholders and hear out all points of view, and particularly from the volunteers who serve on the committees and the subcommittees, and really make this organisation what it is. So thank you for your time, and looking forward to the discussions today.
Thanks very much, Philip. So go on to item two, minutes of the previous meeting. The minutes have already been approved, so I just want to note the minutes, and people can download them if they haven't, if they wish to read them. Minutes of the matters arising in the minutes, the minute six for the 2024 Olympic sailing competition is now effectively redundant given the decision by the IOC. So I don't think we need to cover that, but I will discuss that in a few minutes to the background. Has anyone got any matters arising that are not covered elsewhere in the agenda? I'll take that as a no. Thank you. Now I'm just going to deliver a short report. A lot of the things that are in the report are obviously in the agenda, so I won't overlap to any great degree what we're going to cover through the course of the meeting. But I do want to make a couple of comments about the process with the offshore mixed doubles and Paris 2024. It was really quite a unique experience, I think, for me, in the sense that the offshore community really came together with a great vision for, I think, a very exciting event that, in certainly my view and in many people's views, especially people on this call, but right around the world in our sport and outside of our sport, that this event would have transformed sailing at the Olympic Games. The great thing is, I think the offshore community led this, but then brought the entire sailing community along with us. You know, there were so few exceptions, I think, of people who shared the vision of what this event could have been. And it was really a unique moment for, I think, for the sport. It obviously failed to obtain approval at the IOC level, which is obviously deeply disappointing, I think, for so many people. I think that's the bad news. The good news is, I think we have a great opportunity to still work on the vision and really build on it for future Olympics. And we could debate whether that is LA or Brisbane. But certainly, I think the vision that we all have needs to be redoubled. And obviously, that's going to be part of what we're going to ask Larry to talk to shortly. But I really wanted to thank a large number of people who really assisted enormously in not only building the vision, but also the advocacy of the event. It was really remarkable teamwork. And there were a lot of people, and I'm not going to name them all, but I really, really wanted to thank the staff, so many of the staff, including Jaime and Simon and Alistair, led by David Graham. And David did a terrific job. And, you know, I think from the staff's perspective, Yeah, I really would say that you supported us 100% right along the way, and you're just great partners in it all. But I also wanted to thank so many of the volunteers, especially Stan Honey. Stan and I sort of lived the vision for a long way, and in the early days, certainly Gary Jobson was part of that. And Dina Coalition was absolutely fundamental to it as well. And there are many others, and obviously, yeah, at a slightly later stage, Larry Rosenfeld. So there's a large number of people, and I just really want to thank them for all their enormous efforts, their passion, and their vision for that event. And I think that is a really important part of what we need to do going forward, is to build that part of our sport so we can actually make it just an effectively a no-brainer to eventually get into the Olympic Games in the future. It was only just over a year ago that a number of us got together to create the Offshore Doubles Association with Dina, Stan, Larry, myself, Sarah Kenny, and a number of others involved in that process. So it's obviously, we'll talk about that in a little while, but it's only a year and a bit old, which is quite remarkable. The offshore special regulations is in very good hands with Sally Honey, James Dadd as vice chair, and the rest of the committee. So I'm very pleased the way that that is running, and we've also set it up from many years of being in very, very good hands. And I'd really like to record my thanks to Will Appold and the previous committees for putting us in such good shape in terms of the offshore special regulations. Whilst they're in great shape, there's obviously always lessons learnt in our sport that won't stop. And obviously technology changes as well. And I'd just like to reiterate something that I think is incredibly important for our sport, but is so important for the area of safety and offshore special regulations, is as a sport, it's absolutely essential that when lessons are learned, that they are shared with the whole sailing community so everyone can learn the lessons. In terms of one of the most important areas of safety, we're going to shortly talk about the keel improvements. And Jason and his working party, I thank you very much for taking the lead on that, and look forward to your report shortly. But keeping keels on yachts is one of the most fundamental things we can do. And so I think it's one of the most important working parties, and I'm very pleased that we're making progress in that area, and we'll talk about that shortly. I also encourage the committee to voice any ideas that they might have, either now or in the future, via email to the rest of the committee or to myself and Corinne, in terms about other areas you think that we should embark on, given that we were expecting to be finalising equipment for the offshore doubles. We obviously have the ability to look at other projects over the near term. So if people do have ideas, I would very much encourage you to articulate those ideas to us. So thank you very much. Now, I don't know whether Larry is on the call as yet. I haven't seen him. Simon, can you see him?
Yes,
Yes,
I'm here.
Oh, hi, Larry. How are you?
Hi. Morning.
So, Larry, you're welcome. And I'd just like to bring you in at this point, which is covering item six. So, out of the normal course of the agenda, so Larry can get away a little bit earlier. But I think it's a good segue into talking about offshore doubles, because I think it's such a critical part of what we need to achieve over the next couple of years, is to grow this part of the sport. It certainly allows, I think, boat owners to not worry so much about large numbers of crew, reduce cost, and create some really exciting boats at a smaller size range than some of the other offshore component fleets. So on that note, Larry, I'd like to pass it the floor to you.
Okay. Thank you, Matt, and hello to all of you. Nice to see you. And as Matt said, I think we all did a great job pushing hard for the discipline of offshore doubles. I think we made a lot of inroads. Unfortunately, we weren't successful, but we found out how much interest there was by collecting that interest in a association based around the discipline. It's a little different than basing it around a class with a boat and measurement and all of that, but I think that there was still a tremendous amount of interest. As many of you know, we had 1,800 people sign up from 70 countries, and we've just held our first world championship in Italy, and that was very successful. Ricardo Simonecchi did a fantastic job of supporting it. The Figaro class was very helpful in providing the boats. Ricardo is running another race in a few weeks with those same 10 boats to get them back for the winter. So I think the real focus right now is for the association will be on being a place where people can share the knowledge and share the best practices and what's going on from a perspective of safety or techniques or regatta management and many different aspects. And so that's what we're morphing the association into. You know, when we started, we were primarily advocating for the Olympics because that was what was on the table and we needed to make a very hard push. And as Matt said, I want to echo my thanks to Stan and to Matt and Dina in particular, but also to Philip and Corinne and Dee and many other people who were helping as advisors and sounding board and the staff of World Sailing with Jaime and Simon and Alistair and particularly David, all being huge help to us and to me. So with that, I think the goal right now is really to try to collect the interest. I'm working with some people in Australia right now to make a Offshore Doubles Australia to be under the umbrella of the offshore doubles discipline. And I hope that we can begin to bring together the tremendous interest in England and in France and around the rest of the world to be organized as a discipline. And that's what we'll focus on over the next year. With that, any questions or anything I didn't cover, Matt, that you'd like me to cover?
Larry, I'd be interested if you could just talk to the membership. How has it progressed since? Yeah, well, over the last year, I guess.
Well, we made a big push for membership in the beginning, and I would say over the first number of months, we as I said, got 1,800 members from 70 countries and all six continents. We haven't made a big membership push since the Olympic decision. But I think that's what we want to do is sort of refocus and rebrand and get some pieces on the website and that will really support this community vision, and then we'll begin to make inroads again to build national fleets, regional fleets, and that kind of thing, and have ways for them to share the knowledge. And I think that's what will drive the membership going forward.
I'd certainly welcome if anyone else has questions of Larry to come up on the chat and I can hand the floor to you. But whilst if people are thinking about other questions, Larry, one of the things that we saw early on was the progression of design evolution for that size of boat. I mean, we were looking at around about 30-foot type boats, but what else are you seeing in terms of progression of design and build of boats that are more designed suitable for double-headed sailing?
Well, I think people began to think out of the box a little bit. You know, we had the boats that had already been built, the Figaro 3, which, you know, was a large improvement on the Figaro 2, both of which are very solid boats for offshore. The L30, you know, has tried to make inroads and done a good job. I think the way in which it's, you know, set up with the owners, Rodion's done a tremendous job there. And then with the Dalers and, you know, the Far X2 is now beginning to put boats in the water, and that's a lighter, sportier version I think people will enjoy. Of course, the Jeannot 3300 and a lot of other boats. So I think we've got, 13 different boat classes that are, you know, supporting the discipline. And I think more will come as the interest is there. I think one of the things, Matt, is the difference between the original vision for the Olympics, which was by design, one design, and then the ability to do this with offshore, you know, handicap, so that you don't need to collect all these boats in one place, even, or, you know, you can have races among different boats. And I think both of the rules will support that well. At SURF, the Sailing Yacht Research Foundation that Stan and Dina and I are a part of, we've been working on a way to allow people to race the same boats in different places at different times in different weather and normalize that to what we call the SURF Performance Index as a way to reduce the amount of travel needed, but still get people to race against each other and get sort of an idea of how they're doing. So we're going to try a bunch of different things that will promote the growth of the discipline.
And one last question from me, Larry. Do you just want to briefly talk about what other ownership structures that you're sort of seeing, whether there's yacht clubs or various boat charter companies coming in? Have you seen any growth and development?
Well, I certainly saw a lot of interest, and at the time we were doing the bid for the Olympics, it was by necessity very M&A focused, and so that it made a lot of sense. But we always knew that if the decision went against us, that it would really need to be very yacht club focused or you know, center focused. We had some discussions in Northern Europe with a couple of groups who were interested in creating schools to get people offshore, and the double handing was a great way to do it because you had to learn all the disciplines as opposed to just being in one part of the boat as a specialist. So I think these models can and will begin to crop up, and we want to do everything we can to support them, whether it's through corporate sponsorship, leasing models, school models, or yacht club models where wealthy owners get together and, you know, buy some boats and then have young kids use them as they're learning and then crew for them in fully crewed races on those same boats, perhaps.
Thanks, Larry. We haven't got any more questions for you.
Okay.
So I really, really thank you for all the energy that you put into offshore doubles, and a lot of your advisors are on this call, and a lot of your supporters are on this call. So good luck over the next season or so in terms of building the discipline within the sport. And we obviously, as a sport, need to come back and work out how we're going to tackle this in terms of obviously world championships later in the agenda, but also as for the Olympic Games as well. So thanks very much, Larry. And I think there were no questions have been received.
Okay. Well, thank you, Matt, for putting me early in the agenda. I appreciate it. And good luck on the rest of the call. Thanks.
Sorry, thanks, Larry. Stan, hand raising.
Oh.
Okay, Stan, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, I just, as someone whose life was immersed both in the offshore doubles and in the initiative for the Olympic event, I'd like to also, thank Larry, but I think point out that I think from our perspective, as you said, Matt, the sport of sailing really did get behind the offshore Olympic event. And while we did fail at the IOC, I think it's worth pointing out that we succeeded within the sport of sailing. And in my view, the staff did a perfect job, and the event, the proposed event, was supported to a very high degree by the committees and the Council of World Sailing. And even when the IOC pushed back and asked for alternatives, I think World Sailing at both the committee and the council and the staff level, consistently responded to the IOC that the offshore event remained our first choice. So I'd like to thank, David and all of his staff for doing what in my view, was an absolutely perfect job, in spite of the fact that, we failed at the IOC level. Thank you.
Thanks, Dan. Did somebody else have their hand up? I can't see it on my screen.
No one else, Matt. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, Amy.
Thanks.
All right. Thanks again, Larry.
Okay, thanks.
So we'll now go back onto the agenda, item 4. So working party skill improvements. Jason Smithwick, over to you. You have the
floor. Thank you, Matt. Thank you. And hello to everybody on the call. Nice to see all these friendly names pop up. So as a brief reminder, World Sailing implement the international standard that we've been working on, ISO 12215, in its structural plan review scheme. And we've had that scheme in place for many years now. But over the last couple of years, we've been lobbying ISO to improve the standard, in particular in terms of keel fatigue, as we believe this is strongly linked to a number of keel failures in recent years. So a lot of our work has been directed so far at ISO rather than the technical work of developing the standard, although we have a good idea of where we want to go with that. Unfortunately, the ISO working group developing the structural standard, which includes keel attachments, was disbanded after the last review cycle, and the next systematic review wasn't due to start until July 2022, which is further away than we're hoping. So we therefore wrote to the Secretariat of ISO and the chairperson of the technical committee and requesting an opening of the revision of the standard as soon as possible. And thankfully, they were reactive to that and sympathetic. So they've agreed to reopen it they've opened it already from the 15th of October, and this will run for 6 months. This basically involves, voting of all the international groups involved in ISO standards to agree to open it. But in the meantime, there's no particular chairman that's been offered to that standard group. And so ISO are currently accepting standards or nominations for this standard development. So with this in mind, Simon kindly contacted the naval architect David Lyons from Australia. He's been heavily involved in the standard and also in keel failures, and was also sat on our OSR committee a few years back. And we're pleased that David's nomination is now being considered at ISO. So that's good, because he's close and friendly to World Sailing. So we know we can work with him on that. So we'll just wait to hear from ISO on that. So our task now is to ensure that enough ISO voting members support the systematic review of the standard. And Simon's been looking into that, and we'll be writing letters in the coming weeks and months. It's then to obviously push the working group to make some of the advisory parts of the standard mandatory in relation to keel fatigue, and also increase the current requirements. The current requirements are quite low in terms of, let's say, normal ship fatigue, and we want to make it higher, closer to that, which would then increase structural integrity in that area and hopefully cause less accidents, which is what we're finally aiming towards. So thanks to the working party so far, and in particular Simon and Stuart Carruthers from the International Race Commission, and also David Lyons in their efforts over these past months at this point. I'm happy to take any questions at all through you, Matt. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Jason. And look, thank you very much for your work and the working party. And if there's anyone that I can contact, reach out and Simon can let me know. Certainly be very happy to help. Are there any questions for Jason before we move on? All right, Jason, well, it's over to you again for UMS.
You're going quick. I've got to fire up the next document. So the UMS Working Party has been going on for a number of years. And in our report, because of the new committee, we wrote to remind what we are trying to achieve in terms of the universal measurement system. It's basically to do with digital exchange of information and rating parameters. It's to create a boat passport of measurements. So if you can imagine, you may, let's take IRC and ORC as an example, you may measure once and rate twice. And that's the whole point. So that every rating and every data point in the rating is compatible. So with that in mind, as rating systems, we're constantly updating our rules, adding extra measurements, etc. And we've always kept in the back of our mind to try and keep compatible together. For example, last year we were looking at pole measurements, and now we've got compatible pole measurements between the two rating systems. The other hard difficult part is exchange of information. So this year we've been working at IRC and ORC technical group have been working to create a data standard to which we can exchange information quite easily. And this will help, obviously, in the future, particularly when we do have, for example, joint events, like the Rolex Middle Sea Race that's just gone on now. There's a lot of boats rated both IRC and ORC. So the working party as such don't formally meet. I think we just keep it in our mind, and Zoran and I get together occasionally and work out what's next in terms of our rule changes, and Simon's scrolling through right now. We keep a whole store of all of our measurements and where they're compatible between the two rules. So thanks to Zoran, of course, through this work, because he's also the one doing the work. It's a joint working party between us. I'm just reporting to you now. That's it from me, Matt.
Thanks, Jason. Yeah, no, it's absolutely critical to keep, obviously, OIC and IRC working together constructively on this, and obviously to the betterment of the sport and the betterment for boat owners to get their boats measured once. So thank you very much, Jason, unless there's any questions for Jason. Thank you. We go on to item 5, reports from rating systems, the first one is for ORC. I'd like to invite Bruno to speak, the chairman of Stan has a question, sorry, before we move on.
Yeah, this is just a question for Jason, I think from actually both of us, Matt, associated with the keel integrity. Is it likely, Jason, that there'll be a requirement for funding that the sport of sailing will need to pay for some research and engineering to support our proposal, or is it too early to know?
Through you, Matt. I think at the moment we're in quite a good place in terms of what we require from the standard. Obviously, that's through the kind work of Hasso Hofmeister at DMVDL. And so, whether we have to do any further technical work, I think we'd have to talk as a working party again, but you know, I think we know where we want to go with that. The only sort of major requirement, of course, is sending people to the meeting. And I don't know if David Lyons, for example, will get funding through his national standards organization to attend the meeting, or whether we will have to help as World Sailing. So I think we'll have to find out how he gets on with his nomination, and then whether we want to send any additional, particularly for lobbying the group and making sure this happens at international standards level. We already have Stuart Carruthers, who attends on behalf of the RIA and the UK National Standards Organization. And so, you know, we've got good representation at that point too.
Well, just, yeah, if you do need money, you know, I think we all recall that a number of years ago, the last time we needed money for this initiative, our community of offshore sailing stepped up and, you know, led by, you know, Matt at Solus and ORC and RORC and World Sailing, you know, we were able to raise money. So if you need more money for more engineering this time around, Jason, just be sure to give us a little bit of lead time.
Sure, I will. Yes, certainly. Thank you.
Thanks. Great report.
Yeah, no, it's a good point, Stan. Thank you. And you know, as I said, if there's any assistance in any other area that we can get involved with, Jason, please let us know. And especially if David needs potentially assistance to get there, you know, he can call me or work through you, and we can solve the problems, because this is so critically important.
Thank you. And if there's anybody on listening now, obviously, that's close to their standards organizations in their country, then make sure they're activated to reenact this. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I haven't got any more questions, so I think you're off the hook then, Jason. Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
For all the work you do. Bruno, I was about to hand the floor to you, but now I will be handing the floor to you to give us the ORC report. Thank you very much, Bruno.
Thank you. I don't know whether Simon or Jaime can work the file for me, or I should share my
computer. This is Simon. Francesco is driving the screen and hoping he will find your...
Okay. Yeah, I will try to be quick so that you don't fall asleep. Well, he was very successive this year as well. We had an increase in certificate of 25% thus far at the end of September, and we're issuing certificate in 45 countries. In 35 countries, we have a rating office with a national rating office issuing with our software certificates, and instead for 10 countries they use the central office of ORC. We have at ORC 12 full-time staff, and we produced up to now 13,000 certificates in international club. Most important, recording also what we heard before about offshore doubles. We have 3,300 double-handed certificates. This is an introduction to the submission we made to World Sailing before. 3,300 sailing under ORC rule double-handed means a lot of countries, a lot of people, a lot of races around the world using not only one design, but boats to race against each other under rating rules. This is happening also with IRC as well, as we will hear later on. We held our championship in Tallinn, Estonia, with more than 100 boats, the European Championship in Naples and Capri in May, just right after out of the COVID. We had a marina COVID-free in Capri, where checks and controls were made on the crew. 25% of the crew were every day tested against the COVID. So it was a real task also from the organizing point of view. we had also a sport boat European Championship. We are going to expand also our super yacht rule. 7 years ago, we started this rule for boats that are greater than 30 meters, and we are experimenting since 2 years the multi-hull rule, the ORC multi-hull, that will be launched officially next year, but was tested also this year in two regattas, the Europeana Regatta and the Palma, the Mallorca Multi-Hull Cup in Palma. We also launched other type of certificate, like the non-spinnaker certificate. We feel that there is a group of owners and boats that not only are exploring the double-handed part of our sport, but that are also finding a way to race with less crew on board. And this means sometimes not being able to hoist asymmetric spinnakers, or better, not enough crew to recover the asymmetric spinnaker. This was coming with the ability to have a non-spinnaker certificate for free, while you get also your ORC International or ORC Club certificate. We have an ITC, an International Technical Committee, made up of many technical technicians and designers that are fully working on research and development. I remember all of you that you might not be aware, ORC is a no-profit company made by 44 countries. And all these people is serving voluntarily with our research. All the revenues is invested not only in our full-time staff, but also in research and development. We have a very strong site. Our rule is well known for transparency. So every owner or sailor can go on our website and test his own boat against a change in sail configuration or hull configuration, displacement, whatever, and test what is the result and effect on the rating. We also are providing guidance to the organizer clubs, organizing clubs. We issued the race management guidebook. We had several scoring possibilities, from the very simple one of single numbers to the very most sophisticated one that allow to predict the speed of the boat over the length of the course for each angle of wind and each direction and length of length. We will be running our Congress and our committee meetings later, early November. So unfortunately, I cannot report what happened. We had 13 submissions for the ITC and over 30 submissions overall from all our member national authorities. Therefore, we will be discussing this in the second week of November. We are running also measurement seminars and we visit several countries. The most important one was last year USA, that is joining back with a lot of certificates and with a global switch of very important races like the Chicago races. I think we can look at the plots, and we will report about the championship. The most important part of our championship is to see that there is not a predominant boat that is winning in our classes, but if you look at the scoring board, you see many different types alternating in the lead in different championships. And this is, I think, good for an handicap rule to show that it's capable to rate fairly different type of boats. I conclude with a plot of our trend. If you go to the last page, because I see somebody falling down asleep. Yes, this is a free statistic up to end of September. In green, you have an increase in number of certificates. In red, you have instead a number that is less than the previous year. And at the bottom, if you scroll down a little more, you can see the total up to now. So we are very much up in the trend around the world. If you go to the next page, there is a plot of the trend. And we fully recovered the COVID year, where not a lot of races were performed on the water. And we are confident that our rules will continue their trend in expanding all over the world. I'm available, of course, if you have questions.
Thank you, Bruno. Is there any questions for Bruno?
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Bruno. We'll go on to the IRC rating rule. Jason, welcome back.
Thank you. I'm sorry you have to hear my voice again. Michael Boyd, our chairman, wasn't able to attend the meeting, so apologies sent from Michael. But yes, similarly to us and with IRC, we are obviously managed by a number of rule authorities around the world, 42 around the world on seven continents, and with issuing certificates in around 44 countries. The IRC rule is administered by two rating offices, one in the UK as part of RORC and the other one in France as part of the UNCL, Centre de Calcul. That's a jointly owned rule between the two organisations. The joint figures between both of us show that we've had a good increase from last year, obviously, which was strongly affected by the current situation. And we're back to, you know, getting close to the certificate levels that we saw in 2019. We issued 4,248 certificates worldwide, with many revalidations and amendments and trials, you know, in addition to that. It obviously affected our sailing system season worldwide, particularly in Asia, where we have, you know, a good number of certificates in Japan and Southeast Asia. And so, you know, without some of our major events occurring there. But the expectation is that some, you know, our numbers will continue to recover and, you know, we'll get back to our good number of excellent boats worldwide. So we remain the principal rating system for a long list of events around the world. You know, the big offshore classics, the RORC Transatlantic, Rolex Fastnet, which was a real success this year, the Fastnet going back to Cherbourg. And we had a great number of IRC boats competing. And when we talk about double-handed, you know, of the 300-400 that started, 400 were sort of initially before all Brexit and other considerations. We got down to 300. So, you know, 60 of those were double-handed boats. It shows, you know, the interest in that area of the sport, you know, as Bruno mentioned. You know, we're working now with the CYCA for the Sydney Hobart, and we've just had the Middle Sea Race, which is another great success. It was wonderful to see Scorpius on the start line in Malta. It's a real boat. That we've got the Caribbean 600. We've got the RORC Transatlantic, obviously, just before that. And then all our events down in France, the West and Vuelta, etc. We don't list all our events because our individuals, our countries report, and we've got the link to that in our report to see all the country reports. I'll move on. I won't go too details into the report. In addition, IRC is used for the Maxi Rolex COP, which is a really important event for us. We enjoy our strong relationship with the International Maxi Association, and the Maxi owners are very happy with our rating system there. apart from the super yachts, which is in ORC super yacht, which is two of those four boats, maybe five boats. So that was a real success again. It was great to see them back because they had to cancel the event at last minute in 2020. So I think they viewed it as a great success. In addition, we have our European Championships, which is one of our major events in the calendar. And unfortunately, it was due to be held in Hyères in France, jointly run with UNCL, but it was cancelled due to the situation in France and made it pretty much impossible to run racing. But we're looking forward to 2022, where we'll see our European Championships in the Netherlands, in Breskens, part of the Breskens Sailing Weekend, which is a great weekend of racing. And we'll be having 4 or 5 days of IRC Europeans there in late August 2022. At the time of writing the report, our Congress hadn't met, but we've since had our meeting. And at the Congress, our owners from around the world joined, and we had a digital meeting, but we also managed to get some of us, particularly the French and the UK groups, together in one room, which was great to be doing that again. I hope to be doing that again with World Sailing soon to meet our colleagues. We had some really good discussions around our technical rule changes. Each national authority can put in submissions for rule changes, and also the technical formulation changes that we go through in the IRC rating formula. Of note was that we've had a good engagement with Australia over the idea of running two concurrent certificates at one time, particularly if you want to jump between, let's say, inshore and offshore ratings. But there's many other reasons why you might want to have those two certificates. So we'll be looking at trialing that in the Southern Hemisphere coming up, when we revalidate in June with them. And then also we've done our normal look at the rules and rating changes, which include, rating of larger light fast boats, renewable sources of power included in boat weight, because, we just included engine weight before, but now there's hydro generators, solar panels, etc. There's been a lot of discussion, particularly for us for autopilots. And so we've made it clear that notice of race is the one that defines how autopilots may be used at a race. And that's a rule change that was agreed. And then the dreaded poll situation, I don't think all of us are struggling within the rating world to rate poles, whisker poles, jib sticks, all the different poles and sails that you see on boats. And so we've made a few changes there, and also with our head sails. We've got a rich agenda coming forwards for the next year. And so that includes looking at crew number, keel types, hull types, foils, hydrodynamic and aerodynamic drag, and number of head sails. The list goes on. We work hard as a technical committee formed of groups of the two organisations, RORC and UNCL. And also we'll be looking at engaging our rule authorities further in the technical committee, particularly, in getting feedback from them. We'll be hopefully having a meeting early in next year, get more engagement from the rule authorities, because it's clear they're very interested in IRC and want to work with us further. So the fleet statistics I've sort of described, but like I said, it's a good recovery from last year, and we keep on pushing. Differently to ORC, we find that there is a lot of double-handed certificates, but they tend to just use our standard certificates. You don't have to have a double-handed IRC certificate to race in double-handed. You can use your standard certificate, and as most boats aren't dually configured for double-handed and multi-crewed, a Sunfast will just hold one certificate, for example. So that concludes my report. I'm happy to take any questions, of course. Thank you.
Thanks, Jason. And I very much think that the ability to run more than one certificate, given, say, mainsail changes or possibly other things that might be changing, is certainly beneficial for the sport. And I think it's a terrific move for owners, especially trying to wait, a few days to get a certificate change. So that's an excellent development, I think. So
thank you. Bit of work to do first, but yeah, we'll get there for Australia. Yeah,
that's right. I remember talking to you a couple of years ago about this. So it's good to see. I haven't got any questions so far in the chat. Is there anyone with any questions for Jason? Okay, thanks very much, Jason, again. Item three in five, ORC, IRC, Combined World Championships 2022. I might ask, Bruno, could you update us to begin with? And then I might go back and give the rest of the committee a bit of an understanding of sort of where we ended up, you know, some years ago in this area. But Bruno, over to you to begin with.
Yes. We have been in agreement with the IRC after 2016 to run a combined World Championship. We have been testing the first one in 2018 in The Hague, Holland, and we had some lessons from there, some criticism from the sailors about the type of scoring. We had organized together with IRC a combined world in 2022 that was due to happen in Newport, Rhode Island, USA, from with the New York York Club, but due to the COVID situation, it was canceled. The notice of race of this second event was also criticized from sailors, not because of the intent. That is, the intent is fantastic, because you know that since 15 years, I'm trying personally to push to merge and join the two rules for the benefit of all sailors. But because it is difficult from the way the two rules approach the scoring, the different scoring, to merge results and to try to find a solution that is not upsetting the sailors or disencourage the sailors to attend this event. As a matter of fact, we had in our ORC worlds, not combined, more than 100 boats attending since more than 5 years. And this was the case also in Tallinn this year. When we were in The Hague, we hit less than 100 boats. Maybe it was not for this combined world, but it is difficult for an owner to commit to an event if it is not clear to him what is the type of scoring and what is going to happen at the end. So after the cancellation of New York and some also criticism about the scoring proposal for a New York event, we tried with our technical people, and Jason was one of them, to find out a solution for the event of next year that is Porto Cervo. We made from our side some proposal that was simpler and easier to understand for the sailor, but it was rejected from IRC board. We reached a point in July, August, September, with several mails back and forth from ORC to IRC to try to find a compromise and a solution. And finally, in October, after the IRC board and the IRC Congress, with no reply to our proposal, we decided together with the organizer, your club, Costa Smeralda, to issue the notice of race, giving up the combined event and going only for the ORC Worlds next year. We hope in the future to find a way to sit again together and to find a compromise, so that this is not the end of the story, but it's just a postponement to 2023. But we should be not alone in thinking positive forward. We need also the other part to be on the same track.
Thanks, Bruno. I might just go back a little bit in time to just so people that were there can recall what happened, but the vast bulk of the committee weren't in the meeting in 2016, and it's probably fair to say if you were in the meeting, you'd probably remember most of the discussion because I got it was quite a vigorous discussion at times. The Oceanic and Offshore Committee in 2016, and Stan remembers as well as he was chair at the time, agreed and proposed to council that starting in 2018 and subsequent years, a jointly scored world championship would occur. So that was approved by this committee in 2016 and went to council and was also approved by council. So what Bruno is suggesting here, A, hasn't been approved by World Sailing as yet, and I don't think there's any application to World Sailing as yet for the approval. And so I just remind everybody that in Regulation 25.1, World Sailing approval is required for any event that is described as World Championship. So 25.1 goes on, but essentially what Bruno's recommending requires World Sailing board approval. And obviously the board would listen to the views of this committee upon application. So that's what the way I understand it, and I'm very happy to take any questions or comments on this specific topic now. I think that's everything seems to be quiet. So obviously at some stage there'll need to be an application to World Sailing to gain the approval or otherwise of that event in terms of, so that just needs to be noted. I recognise that there are people from Yacht Club Costa Smeralda on this call. So if yes, they, if any, verification.
Yoko Smeralda is here as an observer, but I am sorry that I have to correct you because there is another regulation that allows ORC to run their world championship every year. So I don't think we have to ask World Sailing permission for what the regulation is already giving to us.
Bruno, I don't think that World Sailing would share your view that yes, you are under the ORC regulations. You are I can put the words in front of me, but you still need approval to run the World Championships. So 25.1 makes it very clear. Okay. I think that's all we can do on that topic for the moment, and we can clarify that with you later, Bruno.
Okay.
We obviously had advice on that as well, so we're. I think it's pretty clear from the regulations anyway.
And Matt, this is Jaime.
Hi, Jaime.
Hi, Matt. Just to confirm indeed that basically every world championship needs approval annually. So there is guidance as to how that approval is given for classes in terms of time frames. That is the only difference against the international, the rating systems. The reference to the timeline is not explicit to the rating system, but the approval is indeed required. So you're correct, Matt. So we do issue annual approval to those events. So we do look forward to get that formal request. Thank you, Matt.
Yeah, thanks, Jaime. Thanks for that clarification. And certainly, I think the intention was in 2016 was, obviously to combine the rating systems. So that was, I think, a very long discussion, and I think it was an excellent outcome for the sport. I think we are now in a situation where, this is a very significant change from what was agreed in 2016 to be implemented in 2018. So we need to carefully consider that. Stacey Clark, I would like to give you the floor.
Thanks, Matt. I was on, as you recall, I was on the committee in 2015, and share the frustration of anybody who was there at the meeting. As I recall it, the debate was in the context of a proposal from IRC to hold a World Championships, and it effectively prevented IRC from running their own World Championships by creating this joint World Championships, which we all supported, because I'm sure I'm not the only one that thinks there's too many World Championships in sailing. But it is worth having that, and people being aware of that as the background. It could be perceived as it was a tactic to prevent IRC having a World Championships. Thank you.
Thanks, Stacey. Is there anybody? Stan, please.
Yeah, I've obviously still have the scars and wounds from that 2016 meeting. And, recently went back through the minutes of our meeting that are still bloodstained, and the minutes of the council. And I think Stacey's right. The original discussion was triggered by, I think it was submission 4516, which was a submission to make a very small change to the regulations to permit IRC to hold the worlds. And that submission was approved. So that was one thing we did. But then the other thing that happened, the other discussion that was triggered as part of that discussion, was Andrew McIrvine and Bruno, left the room, and great credit to both of them. They moved beyond, the heated words that had taken place, and then they came back to the room with a proposal for a joint worlds to help, push the sport well forward into where we all wanted to go with the UMS combining the measurement, and with Bruno and Andrew's, cooperation, the rating systems, moving closer together and cooperating. And so separately, they came back with a proposal, and then we took that proposal, we approved it, approving a joint worlds, and then we took that recommendation to council, and council approved it, and council read it all into the minutes. So unusually for council, where the minutes are sometimes quite brief, in this case, it was considered to be such an important movement for our part of the sport that the council put that entire, agreement and approval for a joint worlds into the council minutes. But I agree with you, Stacey. The other thing that we accomplished, and the thing that in fact triggered the discussion, was a regulation change that allows IRC to hold the worlds if they choose. But of course, that worlds, if IRC wanted to hold it, as Jaime has pointed out, that would need to be approved by World Sailing on an event-by-event basis, as Matt and Jaime have pointed out.
Thanks, Dan. And I think also to clarify another point, because obviously it's difficult to understand some of these things unless you've lived part of the history and understand some of the regulations, and certainly and rereading them, is just to confirm the status between the two rating rules. And Jaime, could you update us as to the status? We obviously understand the status of ORC, but the status of IRC?
Thank you, Matt. Just to confirm indeed that the regulation, and it's 25.5.3, that I'm just going to, bear with me, read it out loud. This qualification to hold a world championship shall include rating systems which are based on measurement and scientific formulation available to all certificate holders or world sailing. Just to confirm that this doesn't grant the right to hold a world championship without world sailing approval. This is what a rating system requires in order to then be entitled to get the world championship approved. That approval is required. And the second reference is obviously ORC sits in the first part, that is the measurement and scientific formulation is available to all certificate holders. And to confirm that the IRC has provided their formulation to World Sailing. This has just been very recent, but we have communicated it to Matt just ahead of the call, and just to confirm it here to everyone joining us today. So from my opinion, obviously, this now applies to both ORC and IRC. So both hold the qualification to hold a world championship, but they do require world sailing approval. Thank you, Matt.
Thanks, Jaime. Thanks for clarifying that. So everyone's understanding the status there. Jason Smithwick, would you like to
comment? I just wanted to confirm that when I was sitting in Jaime's seat, so it's all a bit strange me talking about this in that time. But I went through with the current director of IRC at that point as a World Sailing Technical Director, and also received the formulation at that time. And since we've also supplied it along the way, we've supplied it to the next director who followed me, Carlos. So it's been a periodic update throughout the time.
Thanks, Jason. Bruno.
Yes, I am not so good in bureaucracy. I cannot challenge what Jaime just said. So I think we are talking about IRC and IRC being able to ask World Sailing the permission to host their World Championship. I don't think we are talking about ORC, because Regulation 13.1 exists since 2000 and is allowing ORC to administer and organize its own World Championship under our rule without asking any kind of permission to World Sailing every year. So I think I don't want to annoy the other people, but was one of the deals that I had to make with at those time Paul Anderson when he was getting the special regulation out of ORC. So if you read the regulation 13.1, I think J allows ORC to run on World Champions like we are doing every year.
Yeah, thanks, Bruno. I think Jaime clarified that point. And we've also got Constitution Committee opinion on that as well. So I think that's reasonably clear, but I don't think that we should end up having a legal discussion at this committee meeting, and we can just come back to you and clarify the World Sailing regulations at a later stage. So unless there's any other comments from people, I think we probably need to move on. Any other comments? Thanks, everybody. We move on to item 7, offshore world championships. Alistair Fox. Alistair, are you with us?
Yes. Yeah, hi there, Matt. I can quickly just report on this item and then just give you a quick update on 2022 as well, if that's okay.
Yes, please.
Perfect. So, I mean, maybe just to start, and Matt, thanks for your words earlier around the efforts to get the mixed offshore event into the Paris 2024 Olympics. I think it was
a regulation 13.1.
It was a really great collaborative effort. And Matt, thanks to you and to Stan and Corinne in particular from the Oceanic and Offshore Committee, who really did a lot of work, I know, behind the scenes, and to Larry and to, as you said, a lot of other volunteers and certainly within the office. I think it's fair to say we were all ultimately very disappointed with the decision. Just to reference that, because the backdrop of the offshore world has really been, you know, at times very linked to the IOC decision. As you all know, the 2020 Offshore Worlds was due to take place in Malta using the L30s, but that event was ultimately cancelled because of COVID-19. The plan then was to find a new venue in 2021, still using the L30s. But earlier in this year, the board made a decision that we should simply partner with an existing offshore event organizer to make the implementation of the 2021 Offshore Worlds much more straightforward. So it was agreed that the Nastro Rosa organizers would host the World Championships in September. At the same time, Eurosaf made the decision also to host the Europeans at the same regatta. And this decision was made largely to make it much more cost effective to have a fleet of charter boats and hopefully make it logistically simpler for M&As. During the course of the year, following lots of discussions with Rodion and then Ricardo Simoneski, we decided to change the equipment from the L30 to the Figaro 3. And the event was ultimately, I think, successfully run with 10 M&As from three continents competing. And I think it is really important to acknowledge all the work that Rodion had done previously to really try and get the mixed offshore event up and running and support M&As in beginning their journey in the mixed doubles event, but also to thank Beneteau, obviously, for stepping in and then making sure there was a good fleet of Figaro 3s available for the event, but also to Ricardo Simoneski for going ahead and taking the risk to actually host the event whilst there were still, you know, COVID impacts and travel restrictions that could have impacted the event. So very happy to report that the event did take place. I think looking ahead to 2022, I think it's important for this committee to note that we have not yet selected a venue and we do not currently have a boat partner. So in essence, we do have a blank sheet of paper for how to take this offshore world championships forward. And I think it is really important that we engage with Larry and his offshore doubles organization, but also with this committee to really try and create a framework for the offshore world championships going forward. Matt, again, going back to your point earlier in the meeting about whether there is still an opportunity to bring the offshore event back into the Olympics, whether that is in LA or in Brisbane, I think the offshore world championships could be a very powerful tool in that journey. So we had plenty of discussions before Tokyo 2020 with Larry and offshore doubles about how we could take the concept of the offshore worlds forward. To be honest, with Tokyo and many other issues this year, we haven't managed to really finalize that position. But as I said, I would welcome the input of your committee, whether that's today or through a small group of people who could perhaps work with us in the executive office over the coming weeks. But effectively, we have a blank sheet of paper, and I think it's a good time to reevaluate how we want to run that event.
Thanks, Alistair. Yeah, look, I think we really need to work a way of, you know, just working with you, I suppose, in a smaller group to work out the event as you described. So thanks very much for your summary. That was very succinct. Thank you. Are there any comments or questions for Alistair? I think that's a no, Alistair. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think, seeing we're about halfway during the meeting, if we take a 5-minute break, So come back at 25 to the hour. So that's exactly 5 minutes. Thank you, everybody. I'll see you in 5 minutes' time.
Matt, it's Simon here. Just a bit of an update on attendance. We've been joined by Jose Frères, and we've had apologies from Diane Reed from Canada that she can't attend. So we've got 16 attending at the moment out of 18.
Thanks, and I think Alan Massey's asked the end time is 1500 UTC. It was extended by 1 hour, so 1600 UTC, I think, if I've got my time zones correct. So we have just under an hour and a half, hopefully, left to go. Welcome back, everybody. So we are on submissions from ORC regarding the double-handed world championships. Bruno, just following on from the conversation where we were, we'll come back to you and assist you through an interpretation of the regulations, because obviously there's some measurement of confusion in that regard. So I'll ask the staff to come back and give you a proper interpretation of the regulations. Bruno, can I ask you to present your submission 022-21?
Thank you, Matt. As I mentioned while exposing the statistics of ORC last year, this year we issued 3,300 double-handed certificates with ORC in 25 countries. We believe that a tool to encourage and address this part, this growing part of our sport, is also to have a championship. Here you see the regulation I was reporting, the 13.1J. So the request is for ORC to be able to organize not only the ORC International World Championship every year, but also a double-handed championship. The normal championship that you see that was reported in Tallinn this year is for fully crewed, and the request of the submission is to extend the possibility for ORC to organize also a double-handed championship. And you see in the rationale below why this intent is this was a statistics at the end of July. As I told you, now at the end of September, we are 3,300 certificates. It is also a philosophical matter whether to encourage people to access this type of racing double-handed in an easier way rather than one design with their boats that can race together, different boats that can race together, or instead leave it to the one design.
So this thanks, Bruno. So this is a recommendation from our committee to council, which will be council meeting and be held tomorrow. So we have Bruno proposing this submission, I believe. Bruno, you're happy to propose it,
yes,
no doubt.
Please.
So we would like somebody to second this submission, please. Would somebody like to come into the chat line and second this submission so we can discuss it, put it on the table, and then ultimately vote on it depending on how much debate is required. Thank you, Stan. Stan Honey has seconded. Is there anybody who would now like to ask questions of the proposer? Bruno, would you like to say anything more? Or would anyone like to ask questions or make comments or give their views?
Normally, just to explain to the members of the committee, we receive with ORC bids from race organizers to run this kind of events. These events could be inside or already existing events or single standing events. In our meetings with our class and event committee, we award every year to the bids the championships, just to explain the procedure we are going through.
Corinne, I'd like to give you the floor for your question.
Yes, thank you. Bruno, is as you just said, this championship could be held within another regatta or event. Did you think about having this as during your world championship, fully crewed? Can it be a mixed event with double-handed and fully crewed and being a one world championship? In many events, you have ranking for result for double-handed and for fully crewed. And I think that's a good way to increase the participation of double-handed crew without having another title of a champion or anything. As it has been said before, there is so many title of world champion of any kind, of any, if we count them, I think it's going to be quite difficult. So is it something you've thought about? If
yes, thank you, Corinne, for your question. We thought about this possibility, but the format of our championship is made with two offshore races and five inshore races. And we believe that the double-handed championship instead should be much more focused on offshore races rather than inshore races, because to be able to navigate around the buoys or in Costa race with two people doesn't show the real capability of the crew, that is instead is endurance and tactical work in navigation with more miles to go. So this is why we believe they should be two different events. Around maybe a one already existing event, but there are two different clients, the one for the fully crewed and the one for double hand.
So Bruno, it is possible then that the same boat could win both.
I think that in Regulation 13.2, it is stated that it is not possible.
Okay. Yes, a comment, Kunye?
Yes, hi. From my experience of having run both types of races here in Bodrum, Turkey, we found to run the short-handed races together with the fully crewed ones present difficulty, as sailors would like to join in both events. Some sailors would like to join in both events. Also share the equipment in both events. And I support this handicap racing for short-handed, as I view, it will be a step towards the both mixed double offshore and also in one design. Organizing one design events in larger boats are difficult and costly. and also present logistical problems. So we need to encourage handicap racing in double-handed fashion to give an extra boost to this discipline. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think similar to the previous conversation that we had, or that this really clarifies that ORC would be the sole authority to manage and administer these championships, then obviously it would still be up to World Sailing to then individually approve the various World Championships. So I think unless there's any other debate or comments, then we will put this to the vote. We are going to have to vote around the room. So I think I'm not sure who's doing that from the staff perspective.
Matt Simon here.
Thanks, Simon. So obviously the options you have are to approve the submission, reject the submission, or abstain the vote. Simon, over to you. I haven't got any more comments or questions, so I think we can put it to the vote.
Okay, I will do a roll call. I'll start with Corinne, your vote. Corinne, I'm looking for a verbal vote.
Yeah, I vote against this submission.
Okay. Paddy Boyd. Kunyet from Turkey.
I approve.
D. Kafari.
I'm against.
Bruno Finzi.
Approve.
Jose Frères. Jose Frères, can you hear me? Was on the call, but I can't hear him. Nothing heard. Okay. Yasutaka Funazawa.
Approve.
Just could you say again, approve?
Approve.
Yes. Hilton Hale.
I approve.
Sally Honey.
Approve.
Stan Honey.
Approve.
Simon James.
Approve.
Tatiana.
Approve.
Alan Massey.
Abstain.
Diane Reed can't be with us unless she's on the call now, but she seemed to apologise.
Yeah, they did call a note for advice.
I was looking for Diane Reed, but I didn't hear a comment then.
It was not her, Simon.
No. Okay. Claire Renou, I think she's still out on the water. Tom Rinder.
Approve.
And Kun, Vicky Song from China, can you hear me?
Yes, I will approve.
Thank you. And I return to Matt for your vote.
Approve, Simon, but Beppe is on the line. I can see him, but I can't hear him.
Okay, I'll just see whether I can.
If just to note that Jose Frères is also listed here.
Yeah, that's Beppe Frères. Sorry, Jose Frères. Yes. That person, yes.
So maybe Frères, if you can hear us, if you would like to note your vote on the chat, that's also an option for you. Somehow your audio is not reaching us.
I can see his thumb, but I can't work out whether it's pointing up or down.
I think then that's okay, we can move on.
I think we'll close the vote. Thank you, Simon.
Okay. We have 11 in favour and 2 abstentions. and two against.
Carried. Thank you very much. Item 9, World Sailing Class status to the application for the L30. I'm very happy to allow Rodion Luca to talk to this. I'd like to keep it short in the sense that they're not applying for offshore status as a one design offshore class. And I believe the equipment committee didn't approve it. But I think interesting just to give you a couple of minutes right into to update us on the L30. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Matt, and hello, everybody. I just would like to comment that what I see for development of double hand offshore in the future, because we proved that L30 can be used for double hand. We did twice Europeans, and it's quite challenging to organize, but it is doable. What we are doing now is last year with the criteria, we were missing a second continent. And I just want to say that the fleet of 6 boats will be in December. It will be in United States. And we already agreed with the National Offshore One Design Series that the boats will be presented in St. Petersburg in January, Annapolis Nude Regatta in May, Chicago Nude Regatta in June, same as Marblehead, and also Chicago Mechanic Race. And we have a lot of interest. So what I see is if you will support us, we will be able to offer by the end of 2022, if there will be more interest from sailors to join the class, we will be able to organize a North American double hand offshore at the end of 22, and maybe the World Championship double hand mix by the in United States next year. So we will ask the reason why equipment committee did not really improve yet, because we still need to polish our class rules. And last night we agreed with Dimitris that he will help us, because it's really minor issues, not a big issues to change it. And we will set up a class association meeting online during December or latest January in St. Petersburg with existing class members who will be racing at the Nude series, and also online the guys from Europe. So, and we will approve those changes, which will be recommended by World Sailing to get a perfect class rules. So I see a lot of potential. If you will support, it will give a push for the class, and there will be a charter fleet in United States. And also probably by doing that, some other manufacturers will be able to follow us and do something similar. Because what I see at the moment, to keep the cost low, the trailable boat is really one of the way how to put down the cost for the events. And my last thing is I want to say that this year we get certification from the International Maritime Institute. We developed a longer keel fin, so the boat is with a category A, and it can be raced. It can race any offshore events, including Sydney Hobart and Transpac as well. For the last week in Annapolis Boat Show, we have some sailors who wants to set up one design class for 2023 TP Transpac race to Hawaii, and I'm very excited about it. We already developed the water maker. The one which we will be using for one design, and I think it's going to be help to develop the discipline and the sport in total. And now we are already built 33 boats worldwide, and you can see the numbers all around. So That's what I wanted to say. And hopefully one day in Boston, a Nudrik event, we can sail with Larry, maybe.
Thanks very much. Good to see you, even though it's virtual. The equipment committee deferred their decision in terms of this class status until the mid-year meeting next year. Thanks very much, and we might move on. Review of class status. Just to note, the equipment committee has formed a working party to review existing classes and to represent Oceanic and Offshore on that working party. I think Paddy Boyd has been appointed or will be appointed to that working party. So thanks, Paddy, for your efforts in that regard, given your views. Now we go on to item 10, offshore special regulations. Sally, I would like to give you the floor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Matt. Thanks a lot to Simon and to all the other committee members on the special regulations subcommittee, especially James Dabb, vice chair, and several others who are on the call. I'll try not to take too much time, but I think this is important. Just to note, thank you for the slide up on the screen. Of 11 submissions that we had this year, we rejected 4, one was withdrawn, and we approved 6, 3 with amended wording. I think I'd like to talk a little bit about the ones we rejected, especially 2 of them. The first one was from France regarding sheet winches below deck. This generated the most discussion of all of our submissions. Just to quote quickly, the submission read, when sheet winches are mounted in such a way that an operator is required to be substantially below the deck, an escape hatch complying with OSR 3.06.2 in the cockpit shall be installed. Currently, there is a requirement that sheet winches mounted in such a way that an operator is not required to be substantially below deck. So this contravenes the current requirement. This requirement first appeared to be safety related, adding an escape hatch for safety. But actually, it's really a major change about where winches are located. And what it does is allows crew to be below deck primarily all the time, which has a problem with visibility, keeping a watch. There were also problems with the actual word deck. Am I still being heard?
Yeah.
Yes, Sally.
Okay. Yeah. Fine. Thank you. There was a problem with the word deck, which is undefined, and a definition of substantially. And there were a lot of concerns that this is really only currently affects a half a dozen Emoka boats, but there was concern that there would be a trickle-down effect to future generations. Where is the cutoff? That we would be changing the OSRs for just one niche event. So this one was rejected. The next one that was rejected, navigation equipment for all categories. The proposal was that we would eliminate the requirement to have paper charts in all categories of racing. And it was rejected in favor of carrying at least one small scale chart in case all electronics fail due to lightning or there's a lack of signal in remote areas. So that was agreed. There was another submission. There were actually two submissions regarding the grab bag requirement. It was decided that the entire submission, the entire 4.21 grab bag regulation really needs to be rewritten. And so we did have an agreement between Richard Hinterholer and Roy Van Allen, who were the two submitters of the grab bag submissions. They agreed to work together on an entire rewrite. So that was rejected. And then there was a submission from Canada about life jackets that was rejected as just unnecessarily complicated. It just didn't need to have the additional wording.
Sally,
yes.
Sally, we're just struggling because we can hear your audio, but we've lost screen sharing. The staff are working on it. So we're just trying to work out whether we need to go out and come back in, or we can fix the problem.
Okay.
Just bear with us for a second.
Yep, you bet.
The old technical hitch.
Well, that was.
I've got the video back, but I haven't got screen sharing back at this stage.
Right. I see video. Well, those were the five that were either rejected or withdrawn. So I think it would be great to have the screen sharing.
Yep. We need the screen sharing for the next bit.
Just to say, I did appreciate Simon organizing these submissions into strength of build. You know, he had them all organized for us as we discussed them into strength of build, sheet winches, communication equipment, firefighting equipment, navigation equipment, and grab bags and storm and heavy weather sails jackets. So Simon did a great job of making these submissions well organized so that we could actually discuss them in a more meaningful way. Just chattering here.
Okay, so I think Sally, the people on this call need to go out and then re-log in. And so everyone on this call, if you could just leave the meeting and then come back in, and everything's working. So if everyone could do that, and then we'll rejoin you on the new call. So log out and come back in immediately on the same login details, and we'll bring you into the new meeting without the technical problems. Thank you. Thanks, Jaime. Over to you. Back to you, Sally.
Okay, so I am assuming, do you want me to start from the beginning, or did people hear what I said addressing this?
I don't think you need to go to the reject and withdrawn. I think you can go on from there. Sally?
Okay, so if we could see the next slide. So there were a remaining six submissions that were approved. The first three were approved as written. Canada had submitted In addition to the forced day and trows, it added not applicable to boats with freestanding masts. Thank you very much. So that was deemed quite reasonable and was accepted, approved 9 to 11. The next one was similar, well, not similar, it was to the same requirement. Adding, James' dad suggested that we add another statement to the forced days that specified that the forced day actually needed to be able to hold up the mast as opposed to relying on the luff of the jib to hold up the mast. That was approved. And the third one was from Canada. It was a minor, deemed minor. We deleted the term an open flame from the fire blanket requirement since it was thought that there could be fires generated by also approved. Then there were three additional submissions that were approved after they were amended. So the first one was regarding the standard, there it is. The French submitted a suggestion that the standard C satellite terminal, GMDSS, was obsolete and could be removed. We decided to, after much discussion, we replaced the submission with a standard a satellite device able to send and receive data, and a tracking device that'll be permanently installed and permanently powered up for the duration of the race, and for which the race committee shall have polling authority. That was approved. And there was
race management.
Excuse me?
Telly, the word management remained in the wording. It's only race committee.
Race committee.
Well spotted.
Yes. Yes, it should be. It should be just race committee, not management. You're right, Bruna. Good catch. So, that can be changed.
Yeah, we can take that as a friendly.
Yes, yes, definitely.
I think it was a typo.
I think it was a typo. Then a special exo 6 from the Netherlands was, if we could put that up on the screen, OSR 4.11. The Netherlands had suggested that paper charts are not necessary for category 4 racing. So we, after a bit of discussion, we changed, we allowed that change with the wording navigation charts, light lists, and chart plotting equipment, if electronic only, an independent alternative shall be on board. So that didn't specifically specify paper. And that was approved 7-2. about that. And the final one was a suggestion submission from Canada to rewrite and reorganize the entire storm and heavy weather sales section. I think it's a great improvement. I tried to rewrite this a couple of years ago, and Richard Hinterhalder did a better job than I did. So basically what this does is it separates the sale inventory, what's required on specific boats, from the sale specifications. And previously it was kind of all pushed together in a way that was very hard to follow. The only thing that we modified from this was to remove category three from the storm jib, because it wasn't there before. So we assumed that was a typo in the submission. But other than that, I think it's a great improvement of the storm and heavy weather sales. So those were the submissions that we had, and we would recommend that Offshore approve the six submissions that we discussed for you, that we approved. Do you want me to go? In addition to that, we have quite a few working parties that
Sally, maybe if we just do
that now, or do you want to? Yes, go ahead, Matt.
Maybe we just go and go through these submissions, and as we mentioned at the beginning of the meeting, our intention would be to improve them as a block, unless people want to pull any of the submissions out. So perhaps, firstly, could I ask for someone to second Sally's proposal to approve these submissions? Patty, did you want to make a comment? I don't have you on chat, but I'm not convinced that my chat's actually working.
Matt, I had a query about the last submission, which is there's no definition of what's independent. And I think that might be mathematical. Would it be independent to have two mobile phones, for example, using the same software? Or does the software and the source of the charted have to be independent?
Sally, did you hear that question?
I think so. So the question was, if you had two separate mobile phones, would that qualify? Is that the question?
I think so.
Yeah. Yes. Not only phones, but then software systems that utilize the service, if you know what I mean.
Yes, I think that would qualify. That would be my interpretation of it, that as long as you had two ways to access charts, and you weren't relying on just one, I mean, that would. Are there any other comments from committee members in the audience? I know James is here. And I think Roy Van Eller is here, and Richard Hinterhalder. Comment from James, so I think he agrees.
Bruno.
Yes, I just want to remind to everybody who was not in the subcommittee that this is only for category four.
Correct.
Correct. Yeah. Yeah, thanks, Bruno. I think that's worth pointing out.
Yes.
People miss. Kunet, would you like to make a comment?
Yeah, I have a question regarding the wording independent. And there was a mention of having a tablet or another phone. As long as the data is being received via GPS or cellular systems, having both technology in two different or independent devices would not help the situation. You need the different technology, i.e. maybe paper charts, to back up the other, because you could have data loss in all the systems. Thank you.
That was discussed, and it was decided that with a category 4 race that's near shore, it was unlikely if you had two separate ways of receiving information that it would be a life-threatening event. And just to remind you that EOSRs are trying to restrict their requirements to what saves a life, not is to have.
So could I ask somebody to second the proposal of these submissions?
John, it's Paddy, we'll... I don't have to second that. Or Matt, sorry.
Yeah, say again, Paddy.
I'm happy to second the proposal.
Thank you very much, Paddy. So can I please ask if there's anybody who would like to pull out any of these submissions from our vote. I will still allow any other comments in a minute or any other questions. Is there anybody that would like to pull out any of these for a separate vote? If you could please let us know on the chat line, if possible. Okay, I'll take it that everybody is happy to take it as a block vote. So voting for all the submissions as a block. Is there anybody that now wants to have any other comments or questions regarding any of the submissions proposed by Sally? No comments that I've got. So we have a proposer, we have a seconder, we have no one objecting. So we're voting them as a block. So approve, reject, or abstain. Simon, could you conduct the vote?
I start the roll call. Corinne, your vote.
Approved.
Paddy Boyd.
Approved.
Kunyet from Turkey.
Approved.
Dee Kafari. Dee Kafari, are you on the line? Nothing heard. Bruno Finzi.
Approve.
Jose Frères. Jose Frères, are you on the line? Jose Frères, one more time. Can you talk? Nothing heard.
Simon, I'll just jump in there. It's D. I approve. Sorry, I had a problem with my audio.
Okay, great, thanks. Yasutaka Funazawa.
Approve.
Hilton Hale.
Thank you, Sally.
Hilton, that was a vote in favour, was it?
Yeah, that is correct. Approved. Yeah.
Thank you. Sally Honey?
Approve.
Stan Honey?
Approve.
Simon James?
Approve.
Tatiana?
Approve.
Alan Massey?
Approved.
I don't think Diane Reed is with us today. I don't think Claire is with us. Tom Rinder?
Approved.
Kun Vicky Song, are you with us? Nothing heard. Come back to Matt Allen.
Approved.
Okay, that's Vicky. Thank you. So I come back to Matt Allen.
Approved. Thank you, Simon.
Finally, to note that the Kafari has stated her vote in the chat.
Okay, and she also verbally said it. Jose Frez has just rejoined the call. Pepe Frez, can you hear us? Jose Frez, are you there? We're looking. Can you hear us, Jose Frez? Nothing heard, but otherwise we have a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 in favour.
Thanks, Simon. Thanks, Sally. So back to you, Sally, thank you for your good work, and thank you for everyone for their support. So back to you, Sally.
Thank you, Matt. Yes, and thanks everybody for your support. I think this was a good outcome for the.
Hello, could you hear? Could you hear me now, Simon?
Yes, thank you, and hopefully you approved the special regs.
Simon, this is Pepe. This is Pepe Frères.
Yes.
Did you hear me now?
I can hear you, Pepe Frères. Can you hear me?
Okay, I'm sorry for I have problems, but I'm in favor.
Okay, thank you for your vote. Back to Sally.
Great, thank you, Pepe. I won't take much time with the final slide, which is going to come up any minute now, to talk about our working parties. So there was the Appendix L, which talks about inspecting your boat for problems, especially with keels, will become live, a requirement starting in 2022. And I think, we have heard from about the keel issues that are being addressed in the ISO, but this is within the special regs. We are going to be requiring an inspection. It is very well described in the OSRs and the frequently asked questions. We are hoping that it will be embraced by all the sailors around the world to make sure something like in this picture doesn't happen. There have been incident reports. We had five new ones. We discussed the PRB structural failure. Kevin Escoffier was rescued by Jean Lacan in a very dramatic sinking when his boat hit a wave and folded in half. We discussed Sam Davies' boat hit a whale and the keel was damaged, requiring her to go back to Cape Town. And Horace Herman hit a fishing boat just before the end of the Vendée Globe. So these were three that happened in the Vendée Globe this last year. There was another sinking after a collision with a tugboat that I think Bruno is very familiar with. It was apparently a matter of poor watch keeping at night. All the sailors, all the people on the boat were saved, but the boat was lost. And then there was a final keel failure during the Fastnet, which They were managed to save the boat, but there was a huge amount of water coming aboard, and fortunately they had good pumps that were required by the OSRs. And then the working parties that we have, if there are no questions about the incidents, I think they've been viewed elsewhere too. We have three working parties that are dealing with one, the four-deck chamfer. There are boats that are being built with very extreme angles to their foredecks, and Johannes Christoffers, James Dabb, and Simon are all working on trying to figure out how to keep people on board, where the lifelines should be placed, and how to maintain safety on the foredeck on these deeply chamfered boats. There is going to be a total refinement of the OSRs in the next 3 to 4 years over the course of the quad. James Dabb, Richard Hinterholder, and Johannes Christoffers are working on that. And there's a medical working party that was started by Will Appold last quad, thanks much to Will's work. It is now being led by Glenn Stanaway and myself. And then there are two doctors, one from New Zealand, David Austin, and one from the US, and Andrew Nathanson. And we're currently have submissions in to approve the wording on Appendix J, hypothermia, Appendix H, medical training, and some small changes to the OSRs. So that will be coming up in the next year to be approved. I think that's all for my report. If there are any questions from anybody, I'm happy to try to answer them.
Thanks so much, Sally. And normally we would spend a bit more time on the incident reports, but obviously with a short form or shorter form virtual meeting, we've had to sort of truncate that to some degree. I think it is important to have a look at what's happening, you know, in from an incident perspective. Everyone's got the papers, and obviously we'll sort of effectively take them as read, but obviously if people do have questions, they can come back via the staff. Simon's normally the good conduit on that. I haven't got any questions, so unless that have been lodged with me via chat or via text. So so thanks very much, Sally. Thank you to you and to James Dabb and the rest of your committee for doing such a fine job.
Thank you.
So item 11, the sailor categorization code. We've got some slides. Over to you, Tom Rinder. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Matt. This past year has been one of the most challenging and interesting years, I think, largely unanticipated. On top of the world health situation, we were forced largely because of record keeping to shut down our database that was kept in a server farm because it had to migrate to the cloud, and we were the last remaining Sports Federation whose information was being kept by SODIC manually in their own servers. This was announced in April. I set up a couple of flares and begged the Secretariat to please keep our system live until, if at all possible, early summer, which they did do until June. But comes June, online access to sailor categorization ceased to exist as it had for many, many years. What we put in as an emergency stopgap was a manual application system that basically completed a PDF type form, and the staff, largely upon me, bless his soul, had to manually enter all this data for the number of records that we did receive over the summer. we were able somehow to satisfy the categorization requirements for the ORC Europeans and Worlds, the J70s as well, the MELDIS 24 class, and any other event such as the Swan Nations Cup that did require sailors to be categorized. We're still operating under that system. However, the good news is largely through a lot of work by a gentleman named Paul Deacon, who was overseeing the new development, we are about to launch a system that is all brand new, not just for categorization, but for all of World Sailing's online presence. I'll give you the quick synopsis as to why. What we have been seeing when you log online at sailing.org is really a conglomeration of four different programmings that are all put together with the HTML interface that you see with the video and the fancy different titles. And then, if most of us know, you go back to the technical side all the way on the right of the sidebar, and that lets you into the doorway to our record keeping. We now have a brand new program that is in beta right now. They'd hoped to unveil it this week, but like all things new with software and programming, they're having some recognition problems, mostly to log on between the front end, which is going to be Salesforce, and the nuts and bolts of the programming to give this information structure and be able to call up all these records. So without being too technical, I can only thank David Graham and all the staff for their hard work and support in making this all possible. This is a bit of a PowerPoint that does talk about why we're doing this. And if anybody is interested in the nuts and bolts, I think Simon has the original PowerPoint that was given to me by Paul Deacon. We're happy to share that with you. Just drop him an email and he can send it to you. What we're going to see here is basically a few static screenshots of how it's going to look when we morph to this new system. And hopefully that's going to happen, if not next week, certainly in the early November, by the middle of the month. The same thing is going to happen for sailor categorization. We're now going to see records that look more like what you're seeing on the screen. And it's all new to all of us. The commission is going to see this for the first time once we let the clutch out and make it work. I fully do not know how to navigate around all of this because I've only seen static screen dumps. But I've been promised and I have every faith in their ability to make it all live and functional in about a fortnight's time. So that's the gist of how our year has been. I think we've made immense progress programming-wise, but of course the proof is in how it functions, which I can't tell you I know yet with great certainty. But every confidence that it's all going to function and take place very soon. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Tom. Wow, what a Hello. Enormous amount of done.
Did you hear me now? I'm Pepe Frers.
Yeah, thanks, Pepe. If you could just go on mute, that, unless you want to ask a question. Thank you. Thanks, Tom, and thanks to you and your group to have done so much work behind the scenes, and obviously we're about to see the fruits of all your work very shortly. So that looks terrific. We'll look forward to seeing it in real life. I guess people are going to probably have questions once they see the system live. But I'm assuming there's no questions, and we'll give us the ability to move on. But really, thank you, Tom. What an enormous amount of work that's been for you and your group.
Thank you, Matt. We appreciate your support.
Okay, sorry for interrupting again. I'm with a problem with my computer and a bit late. So in the previous vote for the double-handed, my vote was positive. I don't know if still in time to take that in account.
Yeah, the vote was carried, and I think you you missed the timing of the vote, so it didn't impact it, Beppe. So okay. No problem. No problem.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks. And thanks again, Tom. We go on to item 12. I'm just going to be not going to really going to cover this topic. I'm going to ask David Graham to address this topic because it's been something that's been handled by the CEO and we will also have the ability for a closed-end briefing at the end of this call by Alex, the legal officer of World Sailing. So, David, I don't know whether you wanted to make any comments, and we will allow any comments from people very briefly before we move on in the agenda. And for the people on the committee, we will have a closed session at the end of this conference call, and I would warn everyone that whilst we're in a public forum, to be very careful about what they say, given that this item is still under consideration, is my understanding. David, are you on the line? Would you like to say anything?
I am indeed, Matt. I don't have an awful lot to say, Matt, in terms of this particular case. Yes, I have been dealing with it and been dealing with in that, you know, I'm a conduit between certain people and the judicial board have been handling it. And yeah, it's been an unfortunate sequence of events, really. I think the DEIO, Mr. Dan Nolan, has done an incredibly thorough job on this case. And then we obviously as a federation have to work within the realms of our regulations. And you know, the outcomes we're bound by those regulations, and it wasn't great the way the whole thing sort of came out. And I'll hand over to Alex at the appropriate time, and Alex can give more details on the outcome of that. But you know, I haven't got much more to say than that at this point, Matt.
Yeah, thanks very much, David. And yeah, obviously there has been some change to the regulations of World Sailing.
Indeed.
So just to point that out, I won't go through those changes, but I will allow Dan Nolan to make a brief comment. Dan, just respecting that we are in a public forum, but I will allow you to make a comment. Dan, you have the floor.
Thank you. Can you hear me, Matt?
Yes, Dan, I can. Hello.
As David said, I was the disciplinary investigating officer on this case. And we discovered that Regulation 35 needed to be improved. And I believe that has taken place. And I suspect you'll discuss that in your closed session. It's a shame that technicalities like this can stop things. And I'll go no further than to say I'm disappointed I couldn't continue.
Thank you, Dan. And can I just reiterate David Graham's comments and thank you for all the volunteering you've done for the sport of sailing over many years, and really thank you for everything you've done. I think we might move and we'll obviously pick that up at at the end of the meeting once more. We'll go on to item 13.
Excuse me, Matt.
Yes.
May I be a party of that discussion?
No, I don't think that's possible, Dan.
Thank you.
Item 13, Corinne Oceanic Cordova. Corinne, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Over to you, and I'd just like to thank obviously Christoph for doing this for so many years, and but now in your hands, Corinne, over to you.
Yeah, well, there's quite a lot to do regarding the organization of a calendar with offshore racing. And we can see that it's increasing, and that's great. We can be very happy with that, but it makes quite a lot of problems sometimes when the event are in the same time. And so we have quite a lot of discussion with the organizer and the classes to try to avoid those clashes in the agenda, whether they are a special event or not. I think it's a global problem that we have to solve, whatever they are, what sailing special event or not. And so having discussion early, in an early stage with everyone involved is very important. So and trying to make people to talk together and not just work for themselves, which is good. I think it would be good for everyone to have a more overview of what can be the calendar. And so that's the purpose of the Concorda. And despite the little power we have, I mean, we can't say to anyone, you can't do your event. The power we have and the role we have is to make people to talk together early and instead of fighting at the last minute. So that's what we'll try to do, continue to do. And it has been done perfectly with Christoph and Simon.
Yes, absolutely. And look, it's a very important function of coordination and I guess communication. And then hopefully cooperation amongst all the event organisers and race organisers. So it's a very important. And thank you and to you and Simon for your all your efforts, and obviously Simon being an important part of that for many years. Are there any questions on that before we move on? Or Corinne, did you want to say anything more?
Okay, I'm okay. I think we have a short time, so.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much. Item 14, World Sailing Speed Record Council. Stan, over to you.
Thank you, Matt. I'll keep it brief. It's been interesting. The World Sailing Speed Record Council, which is the organization that authenticates world records in sailing. Simon is a member of it. I'm the vice chair of it. And interestingly, the organization was little affected by COVID just because of the nature of the events. The WSSRC uses local commissioners, so the commissioners did not need to travel across, you know, national boundaries. We found a way for the inspections to be done virtually, you know, using cameras. So that was a workaround for the impediments of COVID. And then the events, the boats that actually pursue records don't need to actually stop in the countries of the start and finish. They can do flybys where they simply, you know, swing through the starting line and then swing through the finish line, as witnessed by the local commissioner and as witnessed by our black box, you know, tracking device. So using those procedures, a number of events were able to continue to take place, or a number of record attempts were able to continue to take place over the last year. Maserati in particular used those techniques and did a tour of Northern Europe and set 5 different world records. One of the Maserati records was interesting, that they took a record away from PowerPlay, another Mod 70 that PowerPlay had just had for 5 minutes. So PowerPlay set the cow to Dinard record just 5 minutes before Maserati took it away. The very successful women this last year, 2 Irish women, the skipper was Pamela Lee, set their double-handed round Ireland record in RL sailing. And Clarice Kramer broke the women's single-handed round the world record. The one aspect of the WSSRC work that has been impacted by COVID is the 500 meter and 1 nautical mile records, that obviously the COVID restrictions have been a bigger issue because of the required traveling. But those events appear to be starting to pick up as the COVID restrictions are reduced. So thank you very much. That's it.
Thanks, Dan. Assuming there's no questions, we can go on to the International Regulations Commission. Alan Massey, thank you for staying on with us, and I'll give you the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and hello, everybody. I'll try not to be too long here. So the International Regs Commission's been keeping a lookout on your behalf over equipment technical issues through ISO, the International Standards Organization, as well as the regulatory side through the IMO, International Maritime Organization. Nothing of major significance has come up since last conference that would directly affect the construction, equipment or operation of yachts or other sport and leisure craft. But we are watching carefully some emerging regulatory and safety issues. And I'll just go through a brief list. First of all, maritime security and piracy, I mean, not at all to be ignored. There are familiar concerns around the Strait of Malacca, the Western Indian Ocean routes off East Africa, the Red Sea, and increasingly the Gulf of Guinea off West Africa. Now, we've previously issued, under World Sailing headlines, security guidance on these areas for yachtsmen, and that guidance now needs to be updated as an action for my commission, and we'll get on with that. There's a lot of emphasis in the IMO currently on greenhouse gas reduction targets, and while these clearly apply principally to ships of SOLAS convention size, we do need to be alert to future implications for much smaller vessels as well. And I imagine we will get involved at some stage. Another area of interest are the evolving requirements of the Polar Yacht Code, which stipulates some specific mandates for routing, environmental protection measures, and search and rescue preparedness. There is a growing aspiration to extend these requirements to smaller vessels, including fishing vessels bigger than 24 meters in length, and at the moment, pleasure yachts above 300 tons. Now, of course, that skips over the head of most of what we do, but some nations and NGOs are pressing for further extensions that could implicate all vessels of all sizes navigating in polar waters. Now, World Sailing has produced, thanks to the efforts of a few really good people, produced an excellent polar yacht guide that takes the spirit of these provisions and recommends applying them to sailing craft in a much more proportional and responsible way. And again, this very useful guide needs updating in light of the ongoing changes to the code, and we're on the case. Patrick Lindquist from the Commission is leading on our behalf with this small working group. There have been some changes to routing measures and traffic separation schemes off Australia, Northwest France, Poland, Western Norway. Some of these could be of interest to our community, and they will, of course, in due course, appear on new charts and sailing directions. There have also been a number of detailed updates to performance standards and carriage requirements for satellite communication systems, mainly again for convention-sized ships, but with potential interest to oceanic sailors, and particularly when they're connected with search and rescue systems. And we're also watching carefully a number of environmental issues regarding marine plastic litter, restrictions on some types of anti-fouling, and the end-of-life disposal of GRP boats. So there could be a lot coming up in that dimension. We're also recently becoming more alert to the new risks to our sailing community that are presented by the proliferation of autonomous unmanned surface vessels. A lot of these vessels have yet unproven technologies for situational awareness and collision avoidance, especially when they're operating in the vicinity of small vessels like ours in congested waters. And there's a hell of a lot to be done on the regulatory front in that dimension, and we'll keep our eyes peeled. Finally, if I may, we've been proactive in discussions regarding the location and the management of containers lost overboard from ships, somewhere between 1,500 and 3,000 a year, actually. And these can be extremely hazardous for yachtsmen. We are hopeful that in conjunction with a number of concerned states, that we can bring pressure to bear on the IMO to produce new regulations requiring the tracking and the recovery of such lost containers. So those are the things that have been keeping us quite busy on the IMO regulatory front. On the ISO technical committee side, it's technical committee 188 mainly, Jason Smithick's already reported on the working group 18 progress on the agenda of working parties for keel improvements. Working group 3, man overboard prevention recovery, Simon Forbes is kindly monitoring the redraft of work in relation to stanchions and tow rails and so on. There's some work to be done on that still, quite important. And then finally on SC1, personal safety equipment, life jackets, safety harnesses and tethers, immersion suits, Stuart Carruthers is monitoring progress as he does in a very methodical and assiduous way on our behalf. So there'll be more to report on that, I would think, in the coming months. Matt, that really sums up a quick run through what we've been up to in the Commission. I can just reassure people that we are watching very carefully and we've got good triggers for when these things come up and start to put us at risk or perhaps at the butt end of regulations that we really don't need. I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Alan. There's obviously a huge amount of content abbreviated in a very short period of time there. And some very important work. And can I reiterate my personal experience of hitting a container? Anything we can do to stop containers falling overboard of ships would be very welcome. It's certainly for us, it was almost a very disastrous outcome. We probably missed it only by millimetres from taking the entire keel off the boat. So thank you for all your work. And I don't think we've got any questions, but anything that we can do to assist you in any of those areas, especially with obviously terrific connections that you have and we also have with the various navies that are especially the Australian Navy, we'd be very happy to help you in any way we can. And thank you for all your work.
That's much appreciated. Thanks.
Okay. Item 16, World Sailing Sustainability Agenda. I'll pass this over to Jaime.
Thank you, Mike. It's just the opportunity to note and remind everyone about our Sustainability Agenda 2013, that where we have made some very serious commitments, and there's a link there provided just to remind everyone where to find them, and the reference to the deliverables through technical standards. Also the link that points out all the different sustainability programs that we have currently ongoing within World Sailing. And then just to know that from World Sailing, we were also involved in the Ocean Race Sustainability Workshop regarding sustainable boat building, chairing one of the working groups linked to how could rules further engage the commitment towards sustainability, and how could rules and regulations and notice of races further promote sustainability in our events and to our manufacturers. And just anecdotal to point out that the life cycle assessment that the 11th hour carried in regards to their IMOCA showed that the carbon footprint had doubled since 2010, and therefore it's clearly going in the wrong direction towards the commitments that we've done. We have now received the report from that workshop, which I will just share with the group, Matt. Thank you.
Thanks, Homi. Is there any questions there? Homi, have you finished?
Yeah, Matt, we will circulate that, sorry, offline. Thank you very much.
Yeah, okay, just to be clear. Sorry, it's 3 o'clock in the morning here, so. okay, thanks very much, Homi. So that brings us to any other business. I'm not aware of any other business that's been lodged before we go into the closed meeting. I know Bruno, you've asked to make a comment. I'll give you the floor in a couple of seconds. The next meeting that we have is obviously the annual meeting that will be I think in Abu Dhabi. And obviously we will work out how we're going to communicate with the rest of the committee in the interim. And so I do expect us to have some meetings, and especially to discuss other topics, but we'll make decisions on that at a later stage. Bruno, you've got a comment. Thank you.
Yes, my question was about the next meeting, and I don't understand whether Abu Dhabi will be a mid-year meeting or a fall meeting. Can you clarify, please?
Yes, I might ask Hami to clarify that.
Hi, Matt. Yeah, just to clarify, the next meeting for this committee will be the annual conference meeting next October, and that will be in Abu Dhabi. But the confusion is that next year we will also be holding the mid-year meeting in Abu Dhabi as well, but only a few committees are meeting then together with council. So it would be only the events and the equipment committee meeting. So for this group, it would be Abu Dhabi in 2022 in October.
Thank you.
Obviously, Bruno, we can decide to have a meeting in between times, whether that is the whole committee or a subsection of the committee to look at working parties or particular projects. So we'll make decisions of that in due course. Any other business? Okay, so it's we're exactly finishing the main body of the meeting on schedule. So thank you, everybody. I would like to invite all the observers to leave and all the committee members to stay for the closed part of the session.